should apply and modernize at their own convenience. And so when they put down what the part of the Constitution that they're using, they'll say, well, we'll use the general welfare clause. That allows us to do anything we want. Or we'll use the interstate commerce clause or the necessary proper clause. So there's a big difference on interpretation. You know, I think what helps most on this and sorting this out is the Constitution is important. We should have a lot of respect for the rule of law. But ultimately, the solution comes not from the document itself, but it comes from the character of the people that we elect to office and their determination and our determination that the goal of government ought to be for the preservation of liberty and not running our lives. Say how you should spend your money only at the permission of the government. It does not give authority for us to police the world. What it does, it writes a lot of prohibitions down and documented and they're precise. And the prohibitions are on the government, not you. And that always comes down. It doesn't take much for anybody to understand what kind of problems we face today. Most people see it in terms of fiscal policy and the budget. We heard about passing the CR. The CR was just passed last week. The CR, which is for this year, it's a little bit late. It was supposed to be passed last October. So we finally got around to passing that. But quite frankly, I was not happy with the CR. The CR was an outrage from a strict constitutional viewpoint. And for that reason, I voted against the continuing resolution. They talk about the huge deficit that we have, and it's $1.6 trillion this year. But the national debt, which is really the number you have to look at, is $2 trillion. But so the proposal in the continuing resolution was to cut the deficit by $38 billion. $1.6 trillion or $2 trillion, and they were going to cut $38 billion. The truth is, it wasn't realistic. It was unreal. The actual expenditures went up $200 billion. And they expect the American people to believe this, that they're getting their house in order. And yet the process continues. The main reason why this happens is they're asking the wrong questions. They think, well, how are we going to tinker with the budget in order to get it in some type of balance? And the question that we should ask is, what should the role of government be? You know, if we as a people believe that the role of government, our government, is to be the police of the world, tell you how to spend every penny you earn, and to get involved in our personal lives, believe me, they need even more money. So we have to challenge that and indicate that what we want is our freedom. We want our liberty. We want choices. Things is that, oh, the people won't take care of themselves, so we're going to take care of them. Well, just think about how they took care of the millions and millions of people that they thought should have a home. Well, that's a good goal. I happen to believe that more people will have more homes and there'll be more prosperity if you have free markets and sound money than if you have government redistributing wealth and giving a house to everybody. Except for one reason, one problem. It was a bubble. It was a predictable bubble. We knew it would come apart. It burst and fell apart. And guess what? Their whole effort to make sure that everybody had a house to live in backfired. Now we have more homelessness. We've had more people lose their jobs. mortgages, and they don't have a house, and we have like 5 million houses on the market today. That is a consequence of bad government. And we have to realize that that type of role for government shouldn't be. What we should have, once again, is a belief and understanding and trust in the free market economy. If you want to have maximum wealth more fairly distributed than any other system. So we as a people need to get more confidence back. Most Americans say, yeah, I believe in the free enterprise system, except for, you know, and then they have their exception. Yeah, the government should be out of medicine, except for the program I'm getting, and on and on. You either believe in freedom and liberty, or you don't.
Since I'm not quite willing to go down and
make sure that they don't operate tomorrow or close them down in one day. I would like to take a very reasonable step, which many of you helped me do last year, at least make the point that until we get them closed down, let's force them to reveal everything they do and put it out in the open.
Continue to go up
interest rates will rise, which will be an enormous tax placed on the American people at the very time the economy still hasn't revived. So, when this knowledge becomes public, I believe the stage will be set for a new setup, a new form, a new standard, a new banking system. There are two choices. One, we can look to the Constitution and say that we ought to have honest money again, and that banks can't create money out of thin air. There'd be no fractional reserve banking. There'd be no fiat money created by the Federal Reserve. Now, the problem we have is the opposition, those in charge, which are international in scope, because it very much involves the IMF and the World Bank and the WTO and this world effort, and they are already talking about what they want to replace, because they know what we know, that the dollar, it is destined to be removed as the reserve currency of the world. So there will be a contest who will be in charge. And I personally strongly vote in favor of the United States being in charge by having honest money and following the Constitution and reject the United Nations and the IMF. One of the reasons that I so strongly object to the monetary system is it encourages, big government. Because the politicians do not have to be responsible. They spend, and for decades now, 30, 40, 50 years, especially since 1971, this is how a politician stays in office. They come and say, what do you need? Yes, oh, I vote for that all the time. Yes, I'll do that. And then they feel like, well, we have to pay the bills, so taxes keep creeping up, but then there's a limit. How high can taxes go? It would be foolhardy to raise taxes right now. But then they borrow a lot, and then there's a limit to borrowing because interest rates will go up. So then they resort to the Federal Reserve. If you didn't have a Federal Reserve buying up treasury bills and monetizing the debt, interest rates would go up, and the Congress would have to slow down on their spending. So the Federal Reserve, they complain about the deficit, but they are the facilitator. They facilitate the whole system and in their effort to create this new money out of thin air. Now, economically, it's a disaster because easy credit distorts the entire market. The most important thing in a free market economy is pricing. If you want to destroy a free market economy, put on wage and price controls. I remember the last time we had wage and price controls was 1971. That was the year, the time that Nixon closed the gold window and put on a high tariff. But put on wage and price control, the market just crashes. Mises, the great Austrian economist, predicted that socialism would always fail because they don't have a free market pricing structure. But what do we have? We have a Federal Reserve that might not believe in, they might not believe in fixing the prices of corn and wheat and steel or whatever, but they believe that they have the wisdom and the authority and the knowledge of how to fix interest rates and how much money supply should be circulated. So they are regulating, they are the central economic planner through monetary policy. And it leads to trouble, it takes a while, but we're there right now. But as a consequence of this, we have trained or taught our people to be dependent. So we have a welfare state overly dependent on the government, just passing out goodies and money, and people are very happy. What it does, though, under this system where you get a free ride and you get to borrow money, is we tend to print a lot of money, and our best export right now is money. So we buy everything from overseas, and we have taught our people that we don't have to be productive, we don't have to be competitive. So we end up buying what we want from other countries in the East, in particular China, and they then, in turn, become our banker, and they loan that money back to us. So the process continues, but it's way out of balance. So our productivity goes down, we get into a recession, the revenues go down, the spending actually goes up, because that's their theory. That's the Keynesian theory. They like to spend, they like deficits, they like regulations, they like borrowing, they like printing press money. So they finally meet up with the crisis that was predictable, which happened in 2008. So what did they do? They increased the spending, They increased the borrowing, they increased the regulations, and they increased the printing press. So it continues, and the deficit explodes. So this is coming to an end, and it's going to be pretty hard to work our way out of it, because I think we will have a major crisis. And when that comes, people are going to live with a standard of living much lower today. But if you study the statistics in the past 10 years, the standard of living for many, many Americans, except the privileged few, the standard of living has actually gone down. There are less jobs, less productivity, and people are working harder to stay ahead. And this is coming to an end, and this is what is happening today, that we will be forced, because of the economic crisis, to revamp and restudy and make the decision on what kind of a country we want. Do we want a country where we take care of ourselves, or are we going to continue to believe that the government will just take care of it? We'll just live to old age and get our Social Security, and we're all going to be okay. If you believe that, I believe you're being misled. But I happen to think that many in this audience would believe that they'd much rather opt out of the system than be left alone and allowed to keep the money.
Afghanistan. You think you'd wake up? And of course,
we've been there 10 years and we're still, you know, plodding along. And the real tragedy is that we have fallen into a trap. I've gotten a lot of support on foreign policy, but I get a lot of criticism too, talking about, defending our country and not policing the world. But Osama bin Laden has written very clearly what his goals were when he promoted the Al-Qaeda. And you have to remember, Osama bin Laden was our ally when we were helping him throw out the invaders and the occupiers in Afghanistan. That's what's so annoying. At one time, we help people like Saddam Hussein and Osama bin Laden, and the next week we change our mind. You know, we prop up a dictator in Egypt, and then we finally get tired of him, and we're out $70 billion. But Osama bin Laden wrote very clearly what his goals were for us. And in some ways, he learned the lessons when we were his ally, and then he was trying to get rid of the Soviets. He says what he wants to do is drag us in and have us spread our military massively over the Middle East or the world, if possible, to drain us. And our military is drained. They're tired out. They're just going back and forth and back and forth. They don't know what victory means. There are restrictions on what's happening because it's an undeclared war, so nobody knows when the war is going to be over. That's exactly what he wanted. He wanted us to spread ourselves throughout the Middle East and as much around the world as possible. And, of course, we did that. And he says his second goal was to bankrupt this country. We would spend so much money, on the militarism that would contribute to our bankruptcy. Seems like he's doing a pretty good job there, and we've fallen into that trap, and we don't back off. We don't remember what President Eisenhower warned us about. Don't get trapped into this militarism, because it's nothing more than supporting the military-industrial complex, and we shouldn't be doing that.
Scared and frightened and annoyed as I was, but I tried to understand what the real
They have no hesitation. They think they know everything they need to know about what they should do with your habits. Yet in this country, we still have a healthy respect for the First Amendment. Most of us recognize that the First Amendment is not there for us to talk about the weather. And I'm pleased that it still exists, that I can still come and get a few things off my chest and talk to a few people like you. So that is very good. We understand that you have freedom of choice of religion and assembly and the press and petitioning the government. And this is all wonderful. But if they're going to trust us with our intellectual freedom and our spiritual freedom, that's a pretty important freedom. We're dealing with our eternity. We tend to trust the people in making these major decisions. At the same time, our government doesn't trust us on what we put in our mouths or what we eat.
Once again, how do you solve problems and where do laws get written when you do things?
have literally legalized it, and some individuals using the marijuana, some of them in, paraplegics and in wheelchairs, have been arrested by the federal government. Say that federal laws always supersede state laws. Your laws don't matter. I would suggest what we need is a greater emphasis on qualification and apply that. Nobody knows that.